Good morning, Green Spring. I'm your host today, Aaron Price, where I love talking about movies more than the Green Spring residents love their new Village Square elevator. And I'm here with our dietitian, Mary Smith. And, you know, usually she's here to talk to us about being healthy and all that kind of stuff, eating right. But today we're talking movies because if you didn't know, Mary Smith is a very much movie buff.
I am a fanatic. I love movies, TV shows. I think that's a great art. And every time we come in here, it's all I talk about, even with you, even though I talk about food most of the time.
No, we have to do a show after the Endgame Avengers comes out, and we're going to talk about all
break
the Avenger movies.
Oh,
I can't wait for that one.
Me too.
Today we're talking about documentaries. Because to me, I love documentaries. I think documentaries is a great form of learning about new aspects of life, whether it's good or bad, that you would have never been able to engage with otherwise than through film. Now, why do you like documentaries?
I like documentaries for the same reason as you. It gives you a chance to learn something that you never would have, but also, like, there's so many books out there, but it can take so much time. And I think that, you know, culture is realizing that video is such an easy way for people to learn and to experience. And then there's something so powerful about what a camera can do. It can really put you in the eyes of a victim or a situation and have you just create empathy for them. And so documentaries are just really powerful to educate and get you to relate to somebody and also have the opportunity to change the way you think about something. So it's really powerful.
I want to touch on what you said. You said about relating to people. You know, I'm an avid book reader and I fall in love with characters and stuff, but there's something about seeing a character and having a face to it that makes me relate a whole lot more, because it's always like, oh, you kind of remind me of my one friend or my one family member, and then you can make that connection and then see things from their perspective.
And I think a documentary is you're really able to see what the director is really passionate about, because they're choosing a specific option with the point to educate you and make you think differently, or tell a story that has never been told before, or tell the opposite side of it, because you know, you'll see a movie or you hear in the news something, but you don't hear what the opposite side, so it can make you completely change everything you thought about a certain situation.
Now, we should do a kind of disclaimer that our documentaries are not always the happiest.
They're not happy.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure mine aren't happy. None of them are happy documentaries. But it's another aspect of life. You know, I live such a happy, good life, and it, you know, documentaries that I attract to or the dark side and maybe the other side of the track. So you have first go of our first documentary of the day.
And so this one is a depressing documentary. So I chose They Shall Not Grow Old, which got a lot of award acclaim this past year, directed by Peter Jackson, who is famous for doing Lord of the Rings. I love this movie. I'm from a military family. So this is all about, it's not an educational documentary, which is a huge thing. Normally documentaries are about education. His sole purpose was to bring a soldier's life to life in a way that has never been seen before to viewers. And it was all World War I units and just showing you what it was like to be a soldier in that time frame. I saw it in a theater with a whole bunch of other soldiers, and there was just like a camaraderie and a power. So after the clip, I'll just go over what he literally went through, and it took him up to 4 to 6 years to do a 90-minute segment just about just because of all the work and detail that he put into it. So it's pretty cool.
All right, let's watch it.
So obviously that was a quick montage, but what I mentioned about documentaries is you're able to relate or see something differently. And I think that when you talk about history, especially wars and soldiers, it's easy to just talk about the reason there was a war, but it's hard to see the soul of the person or the sacrifice that a soldier put in. And this movie, like putting color behind it, mm-hmm. he went back and he went to the specific spots that those clips were taken so he could nail the color perfectly.
Really?
He studied each soldier, like which unit he was from, found their history so that he could match an accent to it. Mm-hmm. And he only had one World War I soldiers narrate it. So like the ones that they had recorded. And just the amount of time and effort he put it behind it, you watch it and you all of a sudden you don't see people who lived 100 years ago. You see people who were mm-hmm. sacrificing for the greater good, and mm-hmm. you walk away just kind of being like, wow, like I had just the amount of humans that go into war, and just mm-hmm. it puts a different spin on it, and it really impacts you on a deeper level, I think.
Well, that sounds like a really interesting. I'm gonna have to check it out. I haven't seen that one.
Yeah.
But speaking along the lines of bringing stories to life, mm-hmm. my first choice is the documentary called I Am Jane Doe.
I haven't heard of this one.
You haven't heard of this one? Well, it's on Netflix. I think it's still on Netflix. And so basically, it's about human trafficking of young girls in America.
Yeah.
And it talks about kind of the website that was around called Backpages. Mm. And think of it as the Supreme Craigslist page, kind of like that. And so where these girls are literally being marketed on this website. And so these parents are saying, why is my daughter being marketed on this website? And they're trying to sue the website and get the CEO of the website, you know, arrested. But there's a law in place that protects the party website from third users posting on their page, that they're not responsible for what people put on their page. So it was a very complex documentary talking, you know, these people's stories, and it was just very heartbreaking just to see, you know, these young girls who get kidnapped or, you know, taken from their family, and then, you know, their vulnerability is just plastered all over the place.
So
what were you gonna say?
It's just like, once again, like things that you would never think happen because we are mm-hmm. in a bubble, basically, because mm-hmm. we do have good lives. So.
And I will say, sometimes we forget that this stuff still happens in America.
Yeah,
we think,
absolutely.
Oh, that happens in other countries, or, you know, mm-hmm. not in our America. So let's take a clip at a small bit of the trailer.
I sent her out with one of her friends, and she didn't come back.
Next thing you know, boom.
She brought her into a life of hell.
Amazon.
You're just a product.
Well, the most popular internet site for escorts is called Backpage.com, where authorities say underage girls are sold for sex.
Backpage is the Walmart of human trafficking. It's an incredibly profitable business.
We will never be the family we were before she was sold on that website.
We need someone to give us a fighting chance.
What if it was your daughter? How would you feel then?
It's a very important case.
Are these people wholesaling children in Washington State or not?
I'd like to meet the member of the judiciary or a member of Congress that thinks that the status quo is satisfactory.
I'd like to call the CEO of Backpage, Carl Ferrer.
What I love about that title,
wow.
Jane Doe, is that this could be anybody.
Yeah.
You know, I only have one little sister, you know, God forbid, that could have been her.
Yeah.
Or, you know, that could be my aunt or a cousin or somebody. And I like how that title says that this could be anybody. This isn't
Absolutely.
An issue that's only for certain people.
Yeah.
And it was such an intense documentary and stuff. So
I think also just building off of that, comparing a documentary to a movie is more an artistic thing. And
mm-hmm.
and at the end of the day, it is about creating a certain amount of money for big picture films.
Mm-hmm.
But a documentary is also to kind of get people to take action. So
mm-hmm.
that's the kind of documentary you watch it and you want to do something. Like
yeah,
you
exactly.
want to learn. Like you said, you know, like you don't realize this stuff happens in America. And
mm-hmm.
this is so good to stay educated on and then take action in any way we can.
Yeah. And I actually, this documentary I saw about 2, maybe 3 years ago, and I think now since then, I know Craigslist at least has certain rulings against third parties, you know, posting
mm-hmm.
that was at first protected. And I didn't look to see what happened to Backpages, but I know there's different laws in place now since this documentary. So like you said, the education piece of this documentary has promoted change
mm-hmm.
and help for victims or those who would have been victims.
Yeah, that's really mm-hmm. important. So that's good.
Yeah, it's good. So
and a very happy one to sit down and watch one day.
Yeah, you know, bring your box of tissues when you're watching this one. Now, this one that we're going to talk about, we both chose the same one. I'm going to let you talk about your clip first.
All right. So I chose Blackfish. And to be quite honest, and please don't hate me when I say this, everybody, I'm not exactly the biggest like animal person. Like, it's just not how I was raised. Yeah, I'm one of six kids. So like, we had kids, not animals. Mm-hmm. But this documentary made me view animals differently. Like, and just the way that they were able. So Blackfish is about killer whales, orcas, and basically what happens to them when they're in captivity. And the way that this filmmaker was able to portray the personality of an animal was very powerful and beautiful. And then on top of that, just show how humans have affected this species. So it's very, very powerful. So I think I chose just the trailer, and you have a different clip, but we can play it and then we'll talk a little bit more.
All right, let's watch the trailer.
When you look into their eyes, you know somebody is home.
They're an animal that possesses great spiritual power, not to be meddled with.
We need SO to respond for a dead person at SeaWorld. A whale has eaten one of the trainers.
Tilikumbo is the one that went after her.
Don is the senior trainer here at Shamu Stadium.
She captured what it means to be a SeaWorld trainer, that it made me realize what happened to her really could have happened to anyone.
I've been expecting somebody to be killed by Tilikum.
We weren't told much about it, other than it was trainer error.
It didn't just happen. It's not a singular event. You have to go back to understand this.
Now, I just love... So, this documentary hit home for me because we're kind of opposites in this. I love sea animals. I love sea animals because to me, they're so fascinating to look at. I love jellyfish, sharks, crabs, all that kind of stuff. And then when I heard about this documentary, it reminded me when I was a kid because I used to watch those Natural Geographic shows.
Yeah.
And I still remember the episode on killer whales.
No way. Wow.
And I still remember that being 5 years old, watching it with my dad. And so this kind of hit home. And so as the audience can see, this involves with SeaWorld trainers being killed because these animals being in captivity for so long, their personalities have changed and they're depressed and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, and something that, you know, you learn that the killer whales, they aren't dangerous in the wild, basically. They would they don't kill other whales, they don't hurt humans, but all of a sudden when you put them in captivity, they were turning against their trainers, like their dorsal fin was going down, and it showed you all these dimensions of animals that you don't, well, someone like me, you didn't know really existed. So that also, once again, kind of brought me into a different place in my mind and life also that I've never been before because I've never thought about an animal that way. So it was cool.
We have to say with this documentary that it is kind of a hit at the SeaWorld company.
It is,
because it talks about kind of the dark things they did to bring this animal to what do you call them, their parks or whatever,
and then to breed them
and then just kind of the stuff that they hid, and they would tell lies. And when you were talking about the dorsal fin, they would lie to the audience saying that it was, oh, that was a genetic reason why their dorsal fin is down, when actually it's an animal sign of depression as to why their dorsal fin was bent over and all that kind of stuff. So so I have a sad scene that from Blackfish that kind of when they just talk about when they capture Tilikum, the main killer whale of the documentary. So let's watch it.
And then they had fishing boats with seine nets that they would stretch across so none could leave, and then they could just pick out the young ones.
We are only after the little one. And little one is, you know, a big animal still, but I was told because of shipping costs, that's why they only take the little ones.
They had the young ones that they wanted in the corrals, so they dropped the seine nets, and all the others could have left, but they stayed.
We're there trying to get the young orca into stretcher, and the whole family is out here 25 yards away, maybe, in a big line, and they're communicating back and forth. Well, you understand then what you're doing, you know.
Sad. I think we forget sometimes that animals do have feelings. The same way, like, yeah. if I had kids, I wouldn't want my kid kidnapped and stuff. But I remember during this documentary when I was texting my friends about it, I said I'm torn at the thought of it because I love looking at animals. Yeah. How else am I going to see them?
Yeah.
And it's kind of a complex situation because obviously I can't go out in the water and look at them.
And it does beg the question, and that, like, don't get mad at me when I say this, but like, what animals, because they, when you talk about the killer whales, especially in this documentary, they educate you saying that whales specifically are highly emotional. They even say highly spiritual. They have like their own languages. So it makes you wonder what other animals have those abilities and then, you know, to make sure we're treating them correctly.
Yeah.
So
I think a lot of animals do. I feel like as time goes on and on, we're learning more that animals have that kind of connection. I think the latest thing I learned about was elephants. Elephants have that connection.
Elephants, so, dolphins, and
all those sweet characters. Animals. So, all right, let's introduce our next film.
This is a rough one, which we both chose. So we both chose Blackfish, and we both chose the Ted Bundy documentaries. Definitely not for the faint of heart. In fact, I didn't even finish it because it was really intense. It's a 5-part documentary on Netflix. I got to part 5 when he was captured. The reason I chose
was it the second or third time he got captured?
Yeah, that's the whole thing. That's one of the reasons I chose it. I had no idea. I mean, I've heard his name a lot, but it was I've never like looked up who this guy was because he's obviously very dark and deranged. But I watched this documentary and was basically mortified because he obviously was a serial killer of about woman my age. And there was no walking down the street. He went from like the West Coast to the East Coast, anywhere. So you can play the clip and I'll tell later after why it really stuck with me.
All right.
My name is Ted Bundy.
I've never spoken to anybody about this. I am looking for an opportunity to tell the story as best I can.
A person of this type chooses a victim for a reason. Possession, control.
There was something unique about Ted's brain. He talked in terms of a voice in his head, and this voice would start saying things about women.
He had very blue eyes. When he really got going, his eyes went absolutely black.
Murder leaving a person of this type hungry, unfulfilled, would also leave him with the obviously irrational belief that that the next time he did it, he would be fulfilled. And the next time he did it, he would be fulfilled. Or the next time he did it, he would be fulfilled.
Yeah, like I said, not for the light of heart. Definitely challenges the viewer and your comfortability factor. So definitely not for everybody. Use your judgment if you want to watch this. Something that I really took away from this movie, though, or documentary, that comforted me, because I needed comfort after watching this as a female, was that basically I don't want to say this like too definitely. I really don't think this could happen again, at least the grand scan, like, scheme that he was able to do it because of technology. One of the things that they focus on in the documentary was how there was no communication between police departments in other states and other counties because they didn't have fax machines. They didn't have scan machines, so they weren't able to send over pictures of evidence or, send over all this information about, hey, we have a sketch of our, accused, like what we think this person looks like. So he was able to get on airplanes, he was able to get on trains, and that's how he was able to get around. And now in the digital age, if someone could probably find where we went shopping last weekend just because of cameras for security reasons. Like, so it was just comforting to me seeing a positive side of what technology has done, and also how we've grown as a civilization showing the communication that has developed from things like this.
And a more morbid take of that is why it can never happen again.
Yeah.
I think people are now not as trusting as they were because of this different serial killers like this. I remember in the movie, they talked, you know, the documentary, they talked a lot about how, because he was such a handsome looking person, a lot of women and people trusted him, and that's how he got into the situations to unfortunately take these women's lives. And I think nowadays, no matter how good you look, women, if they don't know you, I'm not opening the door, you know, I'm not, you know, doing anything with you. We're much more cautious in that sense. And so my clip that I chose from the series was, it was an actual survivor who spoke about when she got kidnapped from Ted Bundy. So let's look at that, and then we'll discuss it.
I thought I could smell alcohol, and that's when he just promptly pulled out his wallet and showed me a badge, and I went, oh, okay. He drove a Volkswagen, which I thought, well, that's kind of odd, but maybe he's undercover. And I got in. He headed down a side street, and then he suddenly pulled over up on the side of a curb by an elementary school. And that's when I just started freaking out. What are we doing? And he grabbed my arm, and he got one handcuff on one wrist, and he didn't get the other one on, and the one was just dangling. I had never been so frightened in my entire life. And I know this is cliche, but my whole life went before my eyes. I thought, my God, my parents are never gonna know what happened to me. The next thing I knew, he had pulled out a gun and said, I'll blow your head off. I just thought, go ahead. Just go ahead. Do it. Just kill me now.
Yeah, kind of a rough moment in it, but, you know, I was glad that at least that young lady survived being attacked from Ted Bundy. And it was just, it's just crazy.
And they were actually able to figure out a lot about him because she survived. Like, they were able to catch him one of the initial times because of her ability and strength and courage to share what happened to her.
But you know what was funny? When she was giving her testimony about it, there were people who were, I guess, fans of his who were, like, yelling at her.
Yeah.
They were like, you didn't get kidnapped. You know, we don't believe you and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
It's just such a trippy documentary, and I'm still shocked that he was able to escape twice.
Yeah. Also, one, like I said, a lot of it wouldn't happen again. That would not happen again.
Yeah, and he was able to just jump out the window.
Yeah, he jumped out of a window, and that would never happen again.
Yeah, so.
Let's hope not, at least. So.
All right, we're moving on time. Okay. So what's your next one?
I chose the Amanda Knox documentary because... So when I was growing up, high school, like, this woman's face was on every single magazine in the grocery store, and I just assumed that she had... killed the Meredith Kircher, the victim of the crime that this movie is going to talk about. And this documentary really showed, like, how you can't trust what social media or publications are really showing you until you hear both sides of the story. So it was really powerful. We can roll the clip.
Did you kill Meredith Kircher?
No.
Were you there that night?
No.
Do you know anything you have not told police?
No.
Italians are calling this the trial of the decade.
We weren't best friends, but I was so shocked by what happened to her.
Their friends were telling us how Amanda had been behaving, performing cartwheels and kissing each other.
This does not look like grief.
I mean, who behaves like that? Of course she did it. She's mad.
Perché la calunniate? Mi potete dare una risposta? Dici, ma chi è responsabile? È un mostro.
That's everyone's nightmare. Either I'm a psychopath in sheep's clothing, or I am you.
Okay, I have to defend this because I know that people might watch that and be like, that's super weird. She definitely did it. If you watch that documentary, you find out, I mean, you can watch even that clip. She's not exactly likable. Like, there's this weird, like, standoffish quality that you get from her. And basically, the press, like, the guy that, the one who ran all the stories about her, didn't like her. And just, he's in the documentary and says that he just wanted to sell. And it was the first time he became well known. He was in all these newspapers. So he said he would create these, like, dramatic headlines to get people to choose to read his stories.
Really?
And it ruined her life. And then, you know, there's no DNA evidence that she was there besides obvious DNA evidence because she, like, physically lived there. And they actually found and arrested a man who is in prison for actually being a part of the murder. And he even said she was not a part of it. But because like like they wanted to sell the story. They wanted to sell, oh, here is this really woman who looks so cute and innocent. Mm-hmm. Really, she's evil. And so that's what Amanda talks about, is either like, hey, I am a psychopath, or one day I could potentially be you. If you get caught in mm-hmm. a something, and someone who has the power to twist the story doesn't like you, mm-hmm. your fate is in their hands. And so it really gets you to stop and think, wow. And not even in the sense of like a crime story like this, but I mean, not to be like super pop culture-y, but like Meghan Markle, there's a lot of like good and bad about her in the news, but it's like, who's writing that? Do they want you to think that she's good, or do they want you to think that she's bad? And it's like, we're giving so much power and not using our own decision to give somebody, you know, mm-hmm. a chance to prove who they are to the world.
Yeah, it kind of denotes to like kind of the scary power of the media.
Absolutely.
That if you get on the wrong side of it and they just keep going for it, it can just go all left field.
And it can ruin lives.
It can ruin lives.
I mean, she's living in like a shed in Seattle now. She doesn't have a life because everyone knows who she is.
Yeah.
For the wrong reasons.
Well, let's move along to the next one. So this one I saw in college, and I still remember this being in Mrs. Fuchs' class, the class that was stressing me out on documentaries. And this was the best one. We used to have to watch a documentary once every class, like every class where we had to watch another documentary. This was the best one. It's called The Imposter. And it's basically about a worst nightmare for a parent of their child goes missing.
Oh, gosh.
And then 6 to 10 years later, imagine getting a phone call saying, oh, we found your child. And then your child comes back, and then you realize, this might not be my child.
What?
So let's watch the trailer.
Hey, Guardia Civil, dígame.
Hello. We found a kid here. He's about 14 to 15 years old.
The thought of what somebody could have done to him, it gives you nightmares.
He doesn't have no IDs, no documents on him. He's very scared.
From as long as I remember, I wanted to be someone else.
We had no idea what kind of person we were getting. He had changed so much.
There was just something wrong about it.
It's a very trippy, and I don't have enough time
really
to go
creepy.
Into what it's about. But all I gotta say is, in the end, I was totally mind blown because you question to the parents, why didn't you notice that your child's eye color is different now? Why didn't you notice that now your child has crooked teeth when they had straight teeth? Teeth go from crooked to straight, not straight to crooked.
Yeah.
Like stuff like that you should have been paying attention to. So it asks a question, what really happened to your kid? Did you have a hand in it as the parent?
It
was such an intense movie, and I actually that's probably the only paper in that class I got an A on because
you really got into it.
Yeah, I liked it so much. All right, we're down to our number one pick, so let's go into it.
My number one pick was Manhunt, which is about the hunt and kill of Osama bin Laden.
Mm-hmm.
A really powerful documentary. We can roll the clip, and I'll talk about it after.
All right.
Osama bin Laden had declared war on the United States, and no one paid any attention.
There were just warning after warning. We knew something huge was going to happen.
I think women make fantastic analysts. We have patience, perseverance.
People who had really deep expertise in Al-Qaeda, they were women.
We were trying to keep track of all the threads of various threats, and the language being used by these guys was like, oh my God, what are they going to do?
This is it. This is bin Laden.
This is on our shoulders.
You definitely need to know your moral center.
My job is to kill Al-Qaeda. Either get with us or get out of our way.
We're going to build from that courier network.
We gained a lot of information out of him, including the name of the courier.
Intelligence operations combined with special operations to create a deadly synergy.
When you do this, eventually you lose one.
How can you have a war on terror when terrorism is a tactic? You have a war against people. So who are the people that we're fighting the war against?
Okay, I really liked this one because... Mm-hmm. I didn't know a lot of it going into it. I didn't know that we had so much intel about 9/11, but not the biggest details. Like, we didn't know what the event was going to be, but watching that, they tell you that they had so much small snippets based off of these analysis, like what these analysis had found, but they couldn't figure out what was going to happen until, of course, it actually happened. I think it also just shows how much the country went through to find him. So once again, you think about soldiers, but you don't think about the people at home that have spent years and years. I mean, there were like men and women who had spent 20 to 25 years like researching this man, researching Al-Qaeda and the sacrifice that they put in. And just, so it really kind of tipped the whole thing on its head. You saw how much work the United States actually put in to capture this man. And so
it was powerful.
It was actually really good. I really recommend that
Netflix?
One. It's on HBO.
HBO. Yeah. I have HBO, so.
Okay, good. Hopefully some other people do too. It's easy. That's one I, number one for a reason.
All right. So my number one, it's on Netflix. It's called it's called 13th. And it's basically about the 13th Amendment that abolished slavery. And it asks the question, did it really set African Americans free or not?
It didn't.
So. Yeah, so because there's a different clauses in that amendment. So the clip I chose is when they're talking with the civil rights leader, Angela Davis, when she fought her trial, because it goes throughout history on how black people tried to fight the oppression happening in America. So let's watch a little bit about her.
Wanted fugitive. I mean, with Angela Davis, the power of the black intellect.
One of the things that we really have to talk about coming to grips with is the whole question of crime. What does it mean to be a criminal in this society?
That had to be broken up.
And in my case, Ronald Reagan was the governor of California. Richard Nixon was the president of the U.S. The whole apparatus of the state was set up against me. And they really meant to send me to the death chamber in order to make a point.
The actions of the FBI in apprehending Angela Davis, a rather remarkable story again in the law.
The system tried to put the sister on trial, and the sister said, no, we putting you on trial. Comes in, big afro, she didn't go press her hair. She was facing major time. You know, most people, they'd have got a nice little press, you know what I mean? They'd have been in there with little white gloves on praying to Jesus. She came in like this. And she devastated the prosecution and walked out of there free.
About this documentary is, you know, not just because I'm African American and just seeing that. What I love about this documentary is just seeing kind of like every time the government kind of did something to kind of oppress not just blacks but other minority groups, there were leaders that rose up. And so it asks the question now, like, where's our leaders now who are helping these minorities to get out of the oppression? And during that time, what I like specifically about the Angela Davis section was talking about these leaders who were there, they were actually fighting the government.
Yeah.
Like, they had the United States FBI after them. Like, you know, we have, you know, if there's a little protest today, you get kind of the city cops, and they were saying, like, these people had the big guns, like the FBI on them. And they had, you know, the vice president and all these people on them, and they were called domestic terrorists. And all they were asking for was just equal rights. And it just begs the question, did the 13th Amendment really set African Americans free? It was such an amazing documentary. I don't know if you've seen it or not.
I haven't, but I'll watch it. And I think that, once again, it just goes to show the power of documentaries. So like you said, you can, it challenges people to rise up. So watching documentaries like the ones that we just talked about, what are you going to walk away passionate about? What are you going to walk away saying, can I take a part in, you know, protecting killer whales? Can I, how can I help a minority? You know, how can I be better with social media? That kind of stuff. It can make you change certain things about your life because it is educational.
Yeah. So sorry, our time is up. I wish we had more time. I know we were going to list honorable mentions, but
another time.
Another time. And they're not happier either.
No.